Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Christian friends, what a pleasure it is to be here with you on this platform this afternoon. Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you've done in our lives. We thank you for blessing us, bringing us through another day, Father Lord. A day when so many died. A day when so many went hungry. A day when so many did not know what to do and were lost. But Father God, you have found us. You continue to be our guiding light. You continue to be Jehovah Jireh, our provider. You have continued to be Jehovah Nissi, our banner. And so you protect us. You direct our path. And we thank you for doing that today, as you've done every other day of our lives. Help us to have faith in you and not be distracted by what we see in the world. Help us as we spend this time together, Father God, to renew our hope, to renew our faith, to renew our joy, to renew our peace, Father God, so that we will be able to walk free in you, showing your love, and in so doing, attracting others to you. So bless us as we spend this time together, focusing on your word, singing hymns of praises to you, and drawing closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A reading from Psalm 37, verses 1 to 7. Do not fret because of the wicked. Do not be envious of wrongdoers, for they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good, so you will live in the land and enjoy security. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him and he will act. He will make your vindication shine like the light and the justice of your cause like the noonday. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret over those who prosper in their way, over those who carry on evil devices. This is the word of God.
The lesson comes to us from Romans chapter 6, verses 16 to 23. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you who were slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from the sin, have become enslaved to righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your limitations, for just as you have once presented your members as slaves to impurity and lawlessness, leading to even more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness, leading to sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what fruit did you then gain from the righteous of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the fruit you have leads to sanctification, and the end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
His word shall not fail.
glory and grace.
Graft to God and be fruitful. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Heavenly Father, we come this time to hear a word from you, Father God, and we pray, O Lord, that I will be the agent of that word, that your word will go out through me without fear or favor. It will be a word that uplifts, a word that blesses, a word that brings hope to those who are hopeless, a word that brings strength to those who are weak, a word that lifts up the downtrodden. And so I pray, O Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart will be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. If you squeeze a lemon, would you get grape juice? Or grapefruit juice? If you squeeze a grapefruit, would you get guava juice? You're saying, but Wendell, that doesn't make sense. How could that happen? And that is true. Invariably, whenever pressure is applied to someone or to something, whatever is inside is what will come out. So, you know, we have a way of saying, she made me do this, or she made me do that. You can't tell someone that they made you curse them. Or you can't tell someone that they made you lash out at them. If the anger was not seething inside of you, if wrath was not on your mind, when they provoked you, it would not have come out. Many times in the Bible, Jesus had many cause to lash out, but he never responded. Pilate asked him all sorts of things, and he could say, oh, how could you accuse me of that? No. He said, you say that. He's on the cross, beaten and stabbed and being tormented, stabbed at his side. And he's saying, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Oh, if we could all reach to that state. But we can. But we need to understand who we are and whose we are before we reach to that state. For man was born in sin. That is our dilemma from the time Adam sinned in the garden. And we hear this in Genesis 6:5-6. The Lord saw the wickedness of humankind was great, and that every inclination of the thoughts of their hearts was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made humankind on the earth, but it grieved him, and it grieved him to his heart. So, left to ourselves, we would naturally sin. But what if there was a way to graft that human flesh and produce great fruit? I am no green thumb, but I'm fascinated by the way people are able to use grafting to bring forth fruits that were never there or they could never have produced before. That process of grafting, it's a process where you find a good branch or the type of fruit you want to produce and systematically join it with the original plant. And over time, despite having the roots of the original plant, you it starts to take the shape of the new plant and starts to bear fruit that more resembles the new plant you have been grafted to. Grafting trees is a practice that has been done by farmers and gardeners for hundreds of years. But the method is not foolproof, because sometimes grafted trees can revert to their original form. So the thing about grafting is that once you do the graft, you cannot leave the tree like that, because there's always the tendency for the original root, which is still there, to spring off new shoots under the line of the graft. And those new shoots will undermine the new tree. So if you always have to, pay careful attention to the grafted tree so that you can quickly prune any new branches that shoot up from the original root and try to return the tree to its original state. Now, what does that have to do with our passage today? Well, the book of Romans is often viewed as Paul's last will and testament, as he lays out the fairly detailed argument about us being sinners and needing to be reconciled to Christ in faith, to God in faith. One particular passage today comes on the heels of Paul laying out in chapter 5, or our particular passage today, sorry, comes on the heels of Paul laying out in chapter 5 our depravity due to our trespasses and sin, and the fact that Jesus reconciles us to God. For Romans 5:18 tells us, "Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all." And he's laying the case for Jesus Christ. He's letting the Romans know that you have a choice, you know. You don't have to go down this way with your flesh and your anger and your lust and pride and all these things. Romans 6:12 further introduces us to that just before our passage we read today, where it says, "Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion over your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions." These passages speak to our depraved states and the first all of Methodism, which says that all men are sinners. So why is Paul making them feel so bad about themselves and so hopeless when he's telling them they can't help but sin? And he said, well, I might as well just pack up and die or just wait to go to hell. But no. He's just really giving them a reality check, because sometimes some of us may be humble enough to know that we're always sinners. But some people might be like the Pharisee who was on the mountain next to the tax collector and saying, "Oh, I am glad I'm not like him, and I fast and I pray and I give my alms and whatever, so I go into heaven." He failed to recognize that he still has flesh and he could be sinning. So, he was given them that reality check that they all needed Christ. He didn't want anybody in the crowd saying, or anybody reading the letter saying, "Well, yeah, let me give this letter to my sister because she needed it, not me. Or let me give it to my neighbor because he needed it, not me." No. He wanted everyone to know that they all needed salvation. And he goes on in Romans to remind them that Christ died for them, and therefore, in Christ, they can be a new creation. But the choice is theirs in terms of who they want to slave to, who they want to be grafted to. And that is why we see the statement in Romans 6:16, which our passage today starts off with. "Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, either of sin which leads to death, or of disobedience, which leads to, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. So, he is laying the case to them that you are on a course towards death if you do not open yourselves. So he is telling them and encouraging them to be slaves to Jesus Christ. And to bring that into context of my grafting illustration, because of Jesus' death on the cross and resurrection, we do not have to pay the price for our sins and could go on to bear good fruit once we are grafted to God through faith in Jesus Christ. But the passage is also saying that we have a choice in the who we are grafted to, and by extension, the kind of fruit we will bear. And similarly, with grafted plants, we can choose not to prune or to prune them, the branches that spring up after the original root. Some of us, we get baptized, we say, hallelujah, I saved. But you ain't seen them in church. You're not seeing them in Bible study. You see them years later, they still can't pray for themselves and go to God in intimacy. And you're definitely not seeing them when you have the walk to feed the people or do something good in society. Because they get baptized years ago, so they save. So they just pack up and waiting for Jesus to come. They don't have to do anything else. That is wrong. That is wrong. We need to continue to prune ourselves every day because that root of sin is still there. And once the root is there in that grafted tree, you know an evil branch could spring up at any time. So we have to keep pruning. And that's what prayer, Bible study, all these things are about. We continuously have to do that. And the motivation for us to do that is laid out in Romans 6:22, which says, but now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification, the end of which is eternal life. So, Paul paints the picture of our condemnation that is caused by our sin, and then goes on to show the light of at the end of the tunnel, the light that shines in the darkness, by showing that in Jesus we all have salvation. And that is emphasized in our key verse today, Romans 6:23, which says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The mistake many of us make is that we feel as soon as we get grafted, we move on and neglect the union. It's not a one and done thing, like how Jesus died for our sins once and for all. We all have to continuously take care of that union, that grafted tree. We often fail to nurture it. We often fail to prune it. And that's why the old branches keep coming up again and again and again and corrupting us and causing us to lead torturous lives, causing us to be bitter and angry and get retaliation from people, or let our pride be hurt and we go out there and take offense and get offended, and then in so doing offend others, and therefore we don't lead a peaceful life. But when we nurture our faith, we are no longer to true, and we nurture our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. We no longer conform to the world, but are transformed by the renewal of our mind. And these things happen. First of all, God's Holy Spirit blocks the flesh from springing forth in our lives. It blocks the flesh from springing forth in our lives because You know, in the Methodist anthem, "And Can It Be?" he says, "Emptied himself but all from of all but love, and clothed in righteousness divine." So if you only have love in you because you are nurturing the Holy Spirit, you may be tempted, but you will not sin, because the Holy Spirit will always be there to block out the desires of that flesh. It will be there to block that sinful root from bearing any kind of fruit. Because Galatians 5 tells us that the Spirit battles against the flesh and the flesh against the Spirit. And therefore, that leads to the second thing that happens when we nurture our relationship with God through Jesus Christ and have the gift of the Holy Spirit. God causes the fruit of the Spirit to spring forth. Because instead of trying to seek revenge on that person who wronged us, we will easily exhibit forgiveness and don't end up in a family feud or squabble with our neighbors. Instead of seeing an opportunity to work and make some money by dishonest gain, well, this is just one little sin, but hey, you'll not be tempted by greed. In fact, you'll be generous. You may even be like the early disciples in Acts 4, where some of them sold all their possessions and brought it into the community. And guess what? They never wanted anything. They never lacked anything a day in their lives. They lived wholesome lives. So, God causes the fruit of the Spirit to spring forth, and that fruit shows itself in love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And if you are exhibiting those fruits and only those fruits, what reason people will have to get vexed with you? They could say, well, he too nice, yes. But you're not giving them any reason to stumble or want revenge for you, on you. And when we live in that continuous state under the Spirit and not under the flesh, that is when the Holy Spirit will lead us to eternal life. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Behold, all things have passed away. He becomes renewed. Be not conformed to the world, but transformed by the renewal of our mind. Sin will no longer have dominion over us. So, Christian friends, as I close, let me remind you, we were born in sin and our flesh continually deceives us. But as we grow in faith and start to put on the mind of Christ, when we graft to God, it gives us saving faith, and our desires change. Our thoughts change. Our actions change, and we attract more positive results in line with what God's purpose for us is. So let us continue in faith and allow God to cause us not to conform to the world, but be transformed by the renewal of our mind, and in so doing, gain salvation and have eternal life. Christian friends, graft to God and be fruitful. Amen.
And can it be that I should again have interest in the Savior's blood?
you for being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.